16 and verse 15. And he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Let's pray. Loving Father, we thank you for this morning's worship. We thank you for your presence in our midst. We know that you are a great and almighty God, a God who lives in unapproachable light, and a God who is immortal. A God who decides what needs to be done, and a God who has the power to deliver it. Once again, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to hear from your word and ministered by your Holy Spirit. Bless this time, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we have been looking at the topic of not being ashamed of the gospel. And related to that, this morning I am prompted by God to speak about the importance of evangelism. The importance of evangelism. If you are a church goer, if you are a Bible reader, you know very well that Jesus Christ has given the Great Commission to his disciples 2,000 years ago. And that same Great Commission has been a part of the church from 2,000 years. And today, since we know about the Great Commission, most of the time what happens is we do not pay the needed attention. And sometimes we even neglect it, or we just keep it aside. But as we are living in the last days, and if you ask me, I would say in the last hours of the last days, it becomes all the more important for each one of us as a Christian and as a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ to take up this task of taking the gospel into the world to every creature. Evangelizing the world is on the top of God's plan. And evangelism is very crucial to the church. It is the primary part of the ministry of the church. In other words, I can say it is the driving force that is behind the church. And when we look at the present day scenario, when we look at church in general, we hardly see church being involved in world evangelization. And some of you might be knowing that, on the other hand, instead of giving out the true gospel, instead of preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, more and more people, more and more preachers are into preaching the prosperity gospel, which is not at all a gospel. So we have a big challenge before us as the children of God and as the followers of Christ. And I think this is a good opportunity that God has given to each one of us to remind us and to once again encourage us, or in other words, as Pastor said the other day, to equip us and to make us excited about the gospel of Christ, which is the power of God to everyone that believes in him for salvation.
Years ago, Thomas Rainer, he wrote a book and he said, the Great Commission has become the Great Omission. So for many believers, they sing about the gospel, they talk about the gospel, but they do not share the gospel. They do not become evangelists in the sense they go out with the gospel and share it with those people who are in need. In general, churches become no more focused, it is no more fervent, it is no more faithful to its Lord's commission. And today, more and more people are interested about their own well-being in the church. They come to church for their own reasons, they come to church for their own needs, they come to church because they have certain sorrows or they are fighting with certain issues in life. So they come for solace, they come for comfort, they come for a kind of encouragement that they can derive from the church. All of that is good, all of that is valid, all of that is needed. But at the same time, once we receive that, we have a responsibility too. We are meant to be the gospel ministers of the Lord Jesus Christ. Every woman, every man, every child, and every elderly person, if he is in Christ and if the Spirit of Christ is in that person, He and she is supposed to be the carriers of the gospel of Christ. Since I have got limited time in this morning service, I want to place four great truths taken from the scripture before you, which reveal to us the importance of the gospel of Christ or the importance of evangelizing the world. The first thing is, evangelism pleases the Lord. Evangelism pleases the Lord. Please turn your Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 2, and we shall read verses 1 through 7. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. Therefore, I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time, for which I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I am speaking the truth in Christ and am not lying, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. There are so many things in that passage, but I cannot, you know, dwell on that passage for long because of the lack of time. But there are two things that, you know, are easily noticeable. One, that God is a savior. God is a savior of all men. And it is the desire of his heart that all men should come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And God is interested in reaching out to the people, and he has chosen us to be his ministers who would go with the gospel. Paul is writing about his own life experience. Again and again, if you read the epistles of the Apostle Paul, he not only reminds himself, but also he reminds the people that are the recipients of his letters that he was specifically appointed by God to be the preacher of the gospel. Now, whenever you come across such a statement, you will easily say, okay, he is a servant of God. He's an apostle. That's why God chose him and God appointed him to do that work. But I'm not an apostle. I'm not a servant of God. I'm not a missionary. I'm not a pastor. I'm a simple believer in Christ. I'm just a disciple in Christ. Why should I take up that task? That would be our natural, you know, reasoning or normal tendency. But when you see the scripture, the commission is not only given to the apostles and the ministers, but it is given to every single member of the body of Christ. Every single member of the body of Christ. So as a Christian, if you truly love your God and if you want to please him, this is the first and foremost thing that should be in your mind. God is the Savior, and we need to present him to the people who need salvation. In the same passage, we also read about Jesus Christ. It says, who gave himself a ransom for all. Jesus gave himself to save all those that need salvation, all those that are there in the world. So this is our responsibility, to take the gospel to all the people. And there is also something that we need to understand. God desires that all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now the church of God, if you read the same epistle, 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 15, it says, but if I am delayed, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of the truth. So God has deposited his truth with the church, and the church is the carrier of the truth that can impart eternal life to the people that are around. So it is our responsibility. Unless you go, unless I go, people will not come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And in these last days, whenever we look at the world's population statistics, it always, I do not know about you, but as far as I am concerned, it always pains me. On the one hand, the population of the world, and most of them do not know Christ, most of them have never experienced the love of God, is growing. And on this side of the world, we see few and few people are actually interested in taking the gospel
and actually involved in taking the gospel of Christ. The leaders of the church have named this meetings as Gospel Fest. And the other day, our dear brother worship leader was talking about why it is, called as a festival. And Jesus also, when he spoke about this in Luke's Gospel chapter 15, he talks about heaven's celebration. I mean, I think we can say heaven also has a kind of festival. And just turn Luke 15 and we'll read verse 7. There the Lord tells us what pleases the heart of God and when God actually celebrates in heaven. Luke 15 and verse 7 tells us.
Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance.
Thank you, brother. So Jesus is saying, I say to you that likewise there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance. So every time a sinner comes to know the saving knowledge of Christ, every time a sinner places his trust in Jesus, every time a sinner truly repents and forsakes his sin and becomes the member of the family of God, there is a great celebration. The heaven is conducting a great festival over that saved sinner. Is it not our responsibility to take the gospel to the sinners that are around us? There are so many sinners in our own family circle. There are so many sinners in our friend circles. There are so many sinners all around us. And it becomes our responsibility to take this great truth so that they would come to know the saving knowledge of Christ. So this is a way we believers can please the Lord. D.L. Moody became a great evangelist of the world. And before he could actually become a true evangelist, he was actually involved in a lot of ministries and he was on 10 to 12 committee boards. If you read his book, he says, and let me put it in his own words, he says, my hands were full. If a man came to me to talk about his soul, I would say, I have got no time because I have to go and attend a committee. But then the great Chicago fire happened. And when I saw many people were burned to death, when I realized that those people who went to a Christless eternity, immediately my priorities were changed. And then I resigned to all the committees, and then I made it as my life's single most purpose to live, to preach the gospel, and to save sinners that are hanging on the edge of hell. And then he became a great evangelist, and then we know the rest of the story. God used him in a very unique way and brought many, many thousands into the kingdom of God. So the first thing that we understand, that evangelism pleases the Lord. The second truth that I want you to notice is evangelism pursues the lost. Evangelism pursues the lost. Go to Luke chapter 19 and verse 10. This is also a very familiar verse. We are all well aware of it, but let me just remind it to you once again. Luke 19, 10. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. This is our Lord's mission statement. Every institution has got a mission statement, and the church, the head of the church, has got a mission statement. For the very purpose of seeking and saving that which was lost, Jesus came into this world 2,000 years ago. The Father sent him as a missionary to the world that is perishing. And Jesus came into the world with that purpose on his mind. And from day one to the last day, he was fulfilling the mission of God in his life. And if we call him as our Lord, and if we call him as our Master, is it not right on our part to follow in his own footprints? That is what we are supposed to be doing. If the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost, then all the disciples of the Son of Man must be doing the same thing. Paul, when he wrote an epistle to the church at Philippi, he says, have the mind of Christ. Philippians 2 and 5, have the mind of Christ. Whenever a Christian has the mind of Christ, he will mind the things of God. It becomes a very big responsibility in his life or in her life. And they will take the gospel and go into every place wherever sinners are. Spurgeon, I believe, who used to frequently say, every generation needs regeneration. Every generation needs regeneration. Regeneration is a theological term which is usually used for saying, every person needs to be born again. Every person needs to be quickened to life in Christ. So every generation needs regeneration. That means every generation of the church must be pursuing the lost. Every generation of the church must be fulfilling the call of God. And the Bible tells us that if you and I are filled by the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit gives us certain fruits, and or in a singular way, Galatians 5:22 actually says fruit. So if we take it, the first fruit that we can experience, or the first fruit that manifests in a believer's life, is love. And we all know John 3:16. 27 years ago, I was saved from a heathen family, from a Hindu family, and God saved me by using John 3:16. And John 3:16 is very, very dear to my heart, because that's where I could see the love of God, and then I was attracted, and then I got saved. And then later on, I became a servant of God with the only intention to spread this love of God and to bring many more into the kingdom of God. If you are filled by the Spirit, you will have that love of God in your heart. And God so loved the world, and you will also obviously love the world, love your own people, and then go to them with the gospel of Christ. At that point in life, you will not feel ashamed to share the gospel. You will not feel scared to share the gospel. You will say, come what may, this is my responsibility. Because I love this person, I want to share the love of Christ with that person. That is the only way we can truly love a person to eternity. Years ago in London, there was a mission, and the mission was having special meetings. So the church, not all in the church, but a part of the church also got involved. And there was a 85-year-old lady. This woman came to the pastor and said, Pastor, I also want to contribute to the extension of the kingdom of God. I also want to do something for this mission. And then pastor said, already you are very old, and you are into old age. It is time for you to sit and rest. But the woman said, no, I do not want to sit and rest. I want to do something for my Lord. And then the pastor said, okay, in your own locality, in your own community, you can go to people and then talk to them about Christ, and then invite them to these special meetings. And this old lady, 85-year-old lady, she went to many homes, knocked on the door, and then she asked permission to pray for them. And since she was a 85-year-old old lady, they did not, say no. They accepted her, they welcomed her. And when she went in, she not only prayed for the family, but she also shared the gospel, and then she gave the invitation to all those families to come and attend these special meetings. And in that locality, wherever she went to the Jews, she went to the Catholics, she went to the Gentiles, and she went to other people from other faiths. And all of them have accepted her invitation. Not many of them have come to the special meetings, but they could, give a hearing to what she has to say. Now, why am I bringing this old lady's story to your hearing? I want to convey a truth that God's children, when they are filled with the Holy Spirit, and when they have a longing for His heart, they will also walk in the same way. As the Lord went seeking and saving the lost, His children, His disciples also would do the same. The gospel is the fuel that powers the church. The gospel is the fire that lights the church. And if the church is truly on fire, it will continue to preach the gospel and continue to evangelize the community. And that is what we need in our day. Elton Trueblood, the Quaker scholar, once compared evangelism to fire. Evangelism occurs, he said, when Christians are so ignited by their contact with Christ that they in turn set other fires. So when you are in constant communion with the Lord Jesus Christ, when you can sense His heartbeat, you cannot sit quiet. You will also go out with the gospel and do some kind of evangelism. Some time ago, an artist, he wanted to, make a portrait of a dead church. So he was visiting certain churches, and then he went to a big church, and in the church, it was a mega church, a whole church was packed, all the pews were filled with people, not a single seat left. And then he looked at the church, you know, it was very grand, all the arrangements were exceptional, the music was good, and the preaching was grand, oratorial, everything was okay. But then he went to the vestibule where he saw the offering plate, and there was a label over the offering plate which read missions, for missions. And it was lying there. Nobody was bothered about the offering plate that was meant to take an offering and send it to the missions. And then he said to himself, now I have got the true picture of a dead church. And he came and portrayed it. What is a dead church? A church that does not live for God. What is a dead church? A church that does not love God. If a church that loves God and that lives for God, it will go out and bring sinners into the kingdom. In John 4:35, the Lord spoke about the urgency of evangelizing people all around us. John 4:35.
Do you not say, there are yet 4 months, and comes the harvest? Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white for harvest.
So Jesus was talking to his disciples, and he was actually talking about their own thinking. You know, some of those people might be thinking this way. That's why the Lord, who knew the minds of man, he said, do you not say there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest? He's talking about their delaying tactics. Most of the time what we do is we say, or we convince ourselves by saying that there is still time for us to go and evangelize. So we want others to take up the responsibility, or we want to buy some more time. But God says, there is no time, the harvest is already ripe, the harvest is ready to be taken into the fold. So he wants us not even to waste a single moment of our life's precious opportunity. We should take every opportunity and go out to win the lost. Are we doing, as a church, what the Lord wanted us to do? That's a question we need to ask ourselves. Number three, the third truth that I want to show, which shows us the importance of evangelism. Evangelism perfects the saint. Evangelism perfects the saint. It not only does great good to the people who are receiving the gospel, but it also does great good to the person who is giving out the gospel. Go to Philippians chapter 1 and verse 27. Philippians 1 verse 27. Paul is writing to the church at Philippi, and he says, only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. He says, let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ. A true saint will prepare himself to share the gospel. And the New Testament shows us how we need to prepare to share the gospel. When we have this burden, we will prepare ourselves in the way that God wants us to prepare. You know, Jesus wants his people, his church, to have a twofold responsibility. One, we must live the gospel, and then we must give the gospel. You must live the gospel, and then you should give the gospel. You must walk according to the gospel, and then you talk about the gospel. That's the responsibility that has been given to the church. And this needs proper preparation. Because so many people who are in the church for years, and they do not even know what the gospel is all about. I think on Friday evening, when I spoke from Romans 1:16, after the message, I do not remember that young, sweet little girl. I think it is Joanna, okay, sister's daughter, Sandeepa's daughter. She came to me and she spoke to me, and she said, Uncle, you spoke about the gospel. Let me also tell you what the gospel is. And she started from Genesis 3:15, and she came into the New Testament. That was very, very wonderful for me to hear. You know, not many people can come and spell out the gospel, but that little cute girl, she came and she was speaking about the gospel with such passion that I prayed for her. Of course, not in her hearing, but I prayed in my heart, Lord, make this child a gospel-oriented person. person. Just like that little unnamed girl took the gospel to that great commander Naaman in Syria, I prayed that this little girl also would be used as an instrument to take the gospel to the needed people. But many people, they do not know the gospel. So they need preparation. And whenever we get ready to share the gospel, we do certain things. We get into a spiritual mode and then we begin to start certain spiritual exercises. When I wanted to share the gospel, you know, as I shared earlier, I was a totally reserved person. I did not like people. I did not want to do anything with people. But God saved me, and then God burdened my heart, and then God gave me this commission, and God called me into the ministry of evangelism, and you should understand my plight. But then I started, you know, searching the scriptures, and then there was an old pastor. I went to him and he guided me. He actually mentored me. And that was of a great help. Then I started studying the scriptures, and then I started praying, and then I started fellowshipping with the right kind of Christians. You know, there are right kind of Christians and wrong kind of Christians. There are Christians who are on fire, and there are Christians who have no fire. So if you are on fire and you fellowship with those Christians who have no fire, very soon, what happens? Your fire also will go. I used to attend a church in a country, and the church was an international church, and it was pastored by an American pastor. And often he used to joke, and he used to say, you know, in my church there are 5,000 people, but I do not fellowship with all of them. I know whom I need to, you know, allow into my fellowship. If I go into their fellowship, I will become like them instead of they becoming like me. So we need to choose the right kind of fellowship. All these things will help us to prepare to share the gospel. Our main responsibility is not only to talk about Christ, but also to reflect Christ. Before you can represent Christ, you need to reflect Christ. You need to show Jesus in your life so that they can see. They may say no to your gospel, but they cannot say no to your life's testimony. And that is what is lacking in the church today. That's what Paul had in his life. Just turn your Bible to Acts chapter 26. The other day we looked at that passage, but let me show you something else there. Paul was before Agrippa, King Agrippa, and he was giving his witness. And in Acts chapter 26, and verse 29, we read, let me read from 28. Then Agrippa said to Paul, "You almost persuade me to become a Christian." Verse 29, and Paul said, "I would to God that not only you, but also all who hear me today might become both almost and altogether such as I am, except for these chains." What is he saying actually? He's saying, I want everybody to become a Christian like me, except these chains. Paul had his conscience clear before God. That's what he talks in Acts chapter 24. So he was a walking Christian. He was a living Christian. He was an obedient Christian. He was a true servant of the Master, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he had nothing in him that could be a problem to the people around. He had nothing in him that could become a stumbling block to the world. So he could say, except for these chains, I want not only you, but all those who are hearing my voice today to become like me. He was living the gospel, and then he was giving the gospel. Can we also say, when we go out and share the gospel with our dear ones, can we also say, except for this? Or do we have a problem in giving our own life's example? Maybe some people, you know, they say, okay, I want you to become a Christian, but except, not like me in the area of bad temper. Except my bad temper, or except my lying, or except my little self-denial for the Savior. Or accept my little half-hearted service for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Be like me, be like a Christian, but except for this. So when we actually get involved in the evangelistic ministry, God gives us an opportunity to perfect our own life, to become more holy, to become more godly, and to become more suitable for the Holy Spirit to take us and use us for the eternal good of those people. And we will not budge, we will not step behind when it comes to share the faith. In Armenia, there was a mission school. And some of the local boys were admitted into that mission school. And two boys, actually they come from Islamic background, but when they were put into that mission school, they were constantly, you know, hearing the gospel of Christ. After a certain time, they both were saved. And then these two young fellows, they went to their friends and they started sharing the gospel. And then God worked in a miraculous way. And then in a year's time, there were eight young boys. And then these fellows came together and they formed a fellowship, and they named it as Home Missionary Society. Home Missionary Society, all young teenagers. And that too in a country which is mostly non-Christian, Armenia. And then they, you know, every day evening after their school was over, they used to go from house to house with the New Testament, and they used to read the Bible, and then they used to talk about the salvation. Then those first two fellows who were saved in the beginning, they said, why are we always going to the people that are in our own village? Why can't we venture out and begin foreign missions and go to the next village? And they went to the next village, 2 miles away from their village. And when they entered the village, there were a group of Muslim men. And they asked these boys, because they knew that these boys do not belong to this village, they are coming from the other village. So these two boys were questioned and asked why they came into this village. And they said, we have come here to share the gospel. And immediately those Muslim men got alerted, and they questioned him, what do you have to say about Jesus? These two young fellows said, Jesus is the prophet of God. And Muslims do not have any problem when you say Jesus is the prophet of God. And they only said that and they left. They were going back to their own village. And as they were going back to their own village, both of them were pricked in their conscience by the Spirit. And they knelt down and they prayed and asked for God's forgiveness. And they got up and they took courage and went back to the same village. You know why? They said, we could not share the gospel fully. We gave them half truth. We did not give them full truth. So instead of going back to our home, let us go back to them and then give the full truth. So they came back, and the same Muslim men were there. And when they saw these young fellows coming back, they asked him, why are you coming back again? And these two fellows said, please give us 1 minute's time, because we gave you half truth. Let us give full truth and then leave. They said, Jesus is the prophet of God. But not only that, he is more and more than that. He's also the Son of God. He is the only Savior of the world. And if any man comes to him and trusts in him, that man's life will be forgiven and he will be given eternal life. Thank you very much. And they left. You know, sometimes we see that God uses little children in a very, very marvelous way. And finally, my fourth point, because my time is coming to close. Evangelism permeates the city. Evangelism permeates the city. That means it goes and gets into the every corner of the city. It invades the city that we live in. Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. Yes.
When the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.
Okay. So here we see God's plan for evangelistic mission. He has actually chalked out a program, and he's showing the early disciples how evangelism must be done. It should begin in their hometown, and then it should go to the neighborhood, and then it should go to the utmost parts of the world. It always begins in our own home. Then it goes to the neighborhood, it goes to the marketplace, it goes to the workplace, it goes to other places, and then it goes to the farthest nation of the world. And evangelizing the people that are in the city is not the sole responsibility of the pastor of the local church. It's not the sole responsibility of the evangelist of the local church. It is the responsibility of the every member of the local church. If you read, I love Paul, after Jesus, the next personality of the Bible is the Apostle Paul to me, because he has influenced my life in a very big way, tremendously. So most of the time I constantly go back to Paul. If not Jesus, go to Paul. So come and see how Paul was led by the Lord Jesus Christ to do city evangelism. Go to Acts chapter 18. Acts chapter 18, verses 9 and 10, I believe. Acts chapter 18, verses 9 and 10.
And the Lord said to Paul,
in a vision,
do not be afraid.
Do not be afraid.
Go on speaking.
And do not be silent.
For
I am with you.
And no one will attack you.
To harm you.
For
I have many in this city.
Who are my people?
Thank you, brother.
Paul was in the city of Corinth.
It's a pagan city. It's a heathen city. A city filled with all sorts of sinfulness.
And then when Paul was sent by God to the city of Corinth, he was threatened.
And then God appears to him in the night and speaks to him in a vision, and he tells him that he has many who are chosen in that city.
So Paul needs to be there and he needs to give out the gospel.
And that's what he did. The next following verses talk about Paul living in the city of Corinth for 18 months, and then the church of Corinth got established.
Praise be to God, the way he leads his people.
And now, you know, when I was thinking about you, you all, most of you came from India,
all of you are from India, I believe, if not from some other parts.
Because I know there are many Indians living in other countries also, but most of you are from India.
You might have come on a job or a project or something else, but on education or whatever it is.
But if you are in this country, you have a responsibility.
If you are in this city, you have a responsibility.
You are a representative of Jesus. You are an ambassador of Christ in this locality, in this community.
And as long as you are here, you must carry this responsibility on your shoulders.
Usually Indians, whenever they are in a particular place, Indians want to fellowship with Indians. Chinese want to fellowship with Chinese, Mongolians want to fellowship with Mongolians, and Americans want to fellowship with Americans.
So the American fellow will not come to the Indian to share the gospel, and Indian fellow will not go to the American to share the gospel.
But in God's plan, it is not so. They began in Jerusalem, went to Judea, then to Samaria, then to the uttermost parts of the world. And that's the reason why Thomas, the very disciple of Christ, came to India.
So it is well and good for you as a church, as Christians, to reach out to the Americans, to reach out to the Chinese, to reach out to the Koreans, to reach out to the Spanish, to reach out to the Mexicans, and to reach out to your own community, Indians.
But most of the time our mindset is so fixed that we think we are Indians, so only Indians will hear us, no American will hear us.
You never know how God can use you.
American may not hear an American, but an American may hear an Indian when he comes with the gospel.
Because most of the Americans know that Indians are from a pagan nation, and most of the Indians are purely idol worshippers.
So why not we venture out, and why not we share the gospel with the people around us?
You might say, already brother, we have a missions week, or we have an evangelism week, when we go and knock on American doors and then we give a tract and give a Bible and then we also evangelize them. But now none of these American fellows are responding to our invitation.
You may say that.
Then I think it was Robert,
I do not remember his name, but the man who actually influenced David Livingstone to go to Africa.
He and his wife, Robert and his wife, were in Africa for 7 years.
He was doing his best to share the gospel with those people. None of them responded.
But after 7 years, after hard, faithful labor, God started giving them fruit.
And these white people began to win those black people.
So in God's eyes, there is no racial boundary. God wants his people everywhere to continue to share the gospel.
And if you are here, you have a mission here to share the gospel.
Jesus began his work by going to Galilee. And then the Bible tells us he was going from town to town and from village to village, sharing about the kingdom of God.
And you remember in Mark chapter 5, there was a demonic.
He was bound by his own, or he was actually filled with so many demons, and then he was kept outside in a cemetery.
The Lord came and met him, and then his life was totally transformed, and then he wanted to be with God.
But Jesus gave him a charge. Jesus gave him a mission, and he told him to go back and talk about the mercy of God, and then to preach about the goodness or the gospel of Jesus Christ.
And the Bible tells us that this maniac turned missionary went to Decapolis. Decapolis means 10 cities.
He did not evangelize one city, but he went to 10 cities and began evangelizing, and then he started how Christ changed his life. Another 5 minutes, I think. 1:15 is my time. Okay, thank you. And in Acts chapter 2, you can read it later. 120 disciples were in the upper room praying and waiting upon God. Then the Holy Spirit comes on them. They all come out into the open. And I think it is 9 a.m. in the morning, and they are giving the gospel in Jerusalem. And there were 16 nationalities. Most of them were people from outside of Jerusalem. They were all in Jerusalem. And these 120, not the apostles, but all the 120 were speaking in their languages. And they could hear and they could marvel. And they said, these fellows, how come they are speaking in our own language and glorifying God? That's where we see God's plan of evangelizing our own cities. And Acts 8 also again shows us that the people, when the persecution began, they were scattered. And those people, when they were scattered, wherever they went, they took the gospel. Acts 8:5 tells us, Philip went to Samaria and he preached Christ there. So it is God's will that we should use every opportunity to go and evangelize. And it should begin with our own place, with our own community, our own city. Let me close with this true illustration. Jimmy Carter, he was a president of the United States, but he was also a committed Christian. He belonged to a Baptist church, Plains Baptist Church. And they used to have a missions week where all the congregation members would be involved and they would take up the commitment and they would go out evangelizing the people. So once he was asked by another church, another Baptist church, to speak on Christian witnessing. So he was preparing about Christian witnessing. As he was preparing his sermon, he wanted to see how many houses he actually visited and did personal evangelism. So he could recollect, and in 14 years' time, he visited over 140 homes and he shared the gospel personally. And then a thought came to his mind. Just a couple of years before, he ran for office. Actually, in 1966, he ran for the governor of Georgia. So during that campaign, he wanted to see how many people actually he met so that he could ask them to vote for him. In 3 months, he met 300,000 people. And then Jimmy Carter put these two things next to one another, and he wrote in his book, he says, for myself, I met 300,000 men in 3 months to get elected to office. And for God's sake, I could only go to 140 families over 14 years. Can I be called a true disciple of Christ? Can I be considered as a follower of Christ? Do I have the qualification to stand up and preach about Christian witnessing? And that was a very, very good self-examination. So God needs people who will take up evangelizing the world. It begins with their world and then it goes to the entire world. May God inspire us to be true to the commission that has been given to us and to the church. Please bow your heads and we'll close in prayer and benediction. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for this morning worship service. God, I confess that many times I have not used the opportunities that you have given me to evangelize. Though I am an evangelist, I have failed many times. Times when my flesh did not want me to go, when my flesh did not want me to share Christ. Instead of submitting myself to your spirit, I surrendered to the desire of my flesh. I confess that you are a merciful God and have mercy on me. And I can also pray for my dear sisters and brothers that are out there. They can also identify with me. Many times they also might have missed the opportunity or simply did not care for it or neglected it in their own lives when you have given them the great opportunity to share the gospel with someone who was in need. Lord, we pray that you will be merciful to all of us, forgive us and cleanse us in the precious blood of the Lord Jesus, Once again, quicken us by your Holy Spirit. Let your Holy Spirit continually fill us with the burden for the lost, and also continually energize us with the power of the gospel, so that we would always be ready and willing and eager to share the gospel and to preach Christ. Because Christ alone is the wisdom, is the righteousness, sanctification, and redemption of all humanity. Lord, thank you for being with us through the service. Thank you for blessing us in so many ways through the service. I pray that you will continue to bless your children as they go out into the world. Whatever needs they may have, you are a holy and heavenly Father, a loving Father. Even before the thought comes to our mind, you know our need, and your hands graciously open, and they grant it generously. Grant it to your children, bless them, strengthen them. Let them not waste their lives for the world, but let them make their lives count for eternity for the kingdom of Christ. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.